So you gained weight in space.
I gained weight. I really like the food, man. It's good. I mean, if you had a pretty much an unlimited supply of macaroni and cheese.
Doesn't it come in like a freeze-dried little pouch?
Well, yeah, it's dehydrated.
Oh, is that what it is?
But it's good. It's macaroni and cheese, one of my favorites. That's dehydrated. Also, shrimp cocktail. Shrimp cocktails, excellent.
Really?
That I think, I don't know if we have stats on it.
Sounds like you guys are living pretty high on the hog up there.
Yeah, of course we are, yeah.
I'll have another shrimp cocktail, thank you.
Do you ever eat that astronaut ice cream they sell?
No.
Yeah,
is
don't
that
eat
the,
that
the,
stuff.
The, it looks like cotton candy.
I don't know what it is. It looks like cardboard.
Yes.
And every once in a while I get like coerced into eating it for, you know, right. Some kid thing or something. Ugh. We don't eat that stuff in space.
You guys have actual food.
We have really good food. Yeah. Chocolate fudge cake, for example, is a very good dessert. If you have this colored cardboard, which is what that ice cream is, or chocolate fudge cake, you're going for the chocolate fudge cake.
Yeah.
Kids love that astronaut ice cream stuff, though.
Yeah. Well,
kids, man, they'll eat anything.
Let's be
honest. They're eating that stuff.
Kids don't know what
they like. But adults aren't, you know, we're not going to get fooled.
Well,
like that.
We've lived.
Yeah, we know what it's like.
We've lived.
Cardboard.
We know better than to eat cardboard ice cream.
Yeah, that's no good. But the food is really good.
Wait, so here's the thing, because I'm trying to figure out.
Yeah.
Aren't you supposed to lose weight in space?
Most people don't gain weight in space. I was one of only two people. When I got back after my first flight, and they get your physical, and they take your blood pressure, of course, all your vitals, and they weigh you. It was like, oh my God, it was like a eureka. He gained weight. They got me in a little bit heavier than when they put me on the spaceship a couple weeks earlier.
How does that happen?
Yeah, so I think there's a couple. One is that I was in really good shape when I left on my space flights. The best shape I was ever in my life. So I think I was kind of low. And then when I got to space, you don't eat very much. One of the reasons you don't eat very much, especially if you don't feel very, very good. You know, I didn't feel very well.
Right.
My stomach, you have a bit of a stomach awareness because your whole system is getting used to it up there. Your vestibular system works on gravity when we're here on Earth. So it tells us we're right side up, we're accelerating, we're moving around.
Right.
As we move our head, if we're running, driving a car, you're accelerating. Right. All that stuff works in concert with your eye movements, with your vision. Now, what happens is when you're in space and your vestibular system stops working because it works on gravity, your brain gets a bit confused because the vestibular system is saying you're perfectly still, but your eyes are saying you're moving. So the first couple of days, you don't feel very well.
So do you feel yourself actually in free fall around the...
No,
free fall, right?
You're going around our planet at 17,500 miles an hour, but really no sensation of speed other than, you know, You look out on this watch, you know, it's, here, California, and then we hit Miami and 10 minutes goes by. You know that's going really fast.
Right.
Right? But you don't feel it. You know, there's no wind resistance. There is nothing. It's just, you know, just this motion.
So how about exercise? Because I thought you guys had
Maybe
to exercise.
Maybe that's why
I thought you
I
had to exercise while you were up there.
That's why I gained all that weight, Chuck. The issue is in space, if you're up there for longer periods, a couple weeks like I was up there with my astronaut friends, not that bad if you didn't exercise, but we still exercise every day. You feel better, of course.
Right.
So every day we got something. If we weren't spacewalking, which is like a pretty big athletic event, you were doing something exercise, mainly riding an exercise bike is what we had on board the shuttle. Mm-hmm. These guys on the space station, these men and women on the space station, if you're up there for that amount of time that the missions are currently, like 6 months, so picture if you were like on super duper bed rest, meaning absolutely nothing. It's even worse than bed rest. Like you lay down for, don't try this, by the way, but if you just lay down for 6 months straight and didn't do anything.
Oh my God, that's my dream.
Yeah, exactly. But it wouldn't be such a good idea to get up right away after those 6 months. So when you're up there floating in space, you're not even using any of your muscles. No load at all is being placed on your muscles or your bone. By load, I mean that no force.
Right,
nothing
there's no force. And that's because you're weightless.
Because you're weightless. So right now, even what we're doing, by moving our hands, by sitting up straight as best we can, getting up and walking around a little bit, we are doing a little bit.
Right.
That keeps us, not doesn't necessarily keep us in shape,
right.
But it'll prevent us from being totally deteriorated after like you would be in space. So right. In space, while you're doing that, if you don't do anything, the body adjusts to that environment in that way. If you're not doing anything, so you'll go through bone loss. Your bones will become much weaker.
Oh, really?
And you'll go through muscle loss, and even your heart will shrink. Your heart's a muscle, right? It's not going to have to pump as hard if you're just laying around the whole time. So by exercising, you're keeping your muscles strong and your bones strong, and everything's working really well. And we've gotten pretty good. The issue with it, though, is that it requires a lot of time. So it's a two-hour exercise period every day, 6 days a week. Every day, 6 days a week. Yeah.
2 hours. And that is that's because the benefits of exercising aren't as intense because you have no force enacted upon you.
Right. So you have, they have there's a treadmill and there's an exercise bike on the space station. There's also a resistive exercise device.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, so you get resistive exercise, which is like weightlifting.
Right.
And because you can take 600 pounds and you and I can just play catch with it.
Nice.
Right, that's a lot. We can't do that here on Earth.
Right.
Right. But in space, since you won't have the weights, right, you have mass but not weight.
You have mass, no weight.
Weight, but yeah, right. So because you need gravity for it to actually weigh something, so big barbells and dumbbells aren't going to help you.
Right.
So what we use is this resistive exercise device, which works on springs, pulleys, kind of like a TheraBand.
Right. Yeah.
That
resistance.
So you
bands.
Give resistance exactly.
Yeah.
So this allows you to get a full body workout. You can do squats and curls and bench and everything else like you would, but you do it with this special machine.
And now I just want to go to space to lift 600 pounds, to bench 600
pounds. We moved around. We were at spacewalking. We handled these big instruments weighing a few hundred pounds like they were nothing. You got to be careful. Then they get away from you easily, too. So you got to be careful with that stuff.
We have forces enacted upon us here on Earth. Why don't they just create that up there? Like, what was that? Space Odyssey, 2001 Space
Odyssey. Yeah, they're rotating around there.
To create.
That requires, that would be cool, right? But that requires a really big spaceship, or it requires a lot of room. I had a friend of mine in grad school who did his thesis. When he had his idea and the equipment he built was a centrifuge that you could sleep on. So you wouldn't waste any time during the day. And you were spun. It was a rotating bed. So your head was at the center of it. So you wouldn't get this Coriolis effect that wig you out, right? So, and it would rotate you, and that's that rotation, like sleeping in a centrifuge, and that would put force on your body, and that would help. But that was pretty big, man. That was really big.
The bed was big?
The bed, yeah, because you have to put a bed in, and it's got to rotate. You need a lot of room for that.
Right, right, right.
So it's a little impractical.
So it was like a localized artificial gravity environment.
Correct, yeah. But if you could produce an artificial gravity environment by rotating them enough, that would probably be a good idea.
Yeah.
But I don't know what that would be like. I think... Because if you're rotating someone, it was during sleeping, but for a room to be spinning, I think you need a really big room.
Or a lot of alcohol.
A lot of alcohol. Because if it's spinning, then it gets worse. So
for the room to be spinning, that's
so
all
I think,
I'm saying.
I think you really need it, because if we were in a rotating room, I think that would be a little disconcerting.
Yeah, without a doubt.
Yeah. Well,
so artificial gravity is probably not something we're going to see then. If it takes a huge space station.
Yeah, probably. Unless they figure out a better way to do it. The transportation mode is the other thing. If you can get places more quickly, then you don't have to worry about floating around as much. But when we get to planets, like if even on the moon, you have 1/6 gravity. Mars, you have 1/6 gravity. So you have a little bit of gravity there, which is very helpful.
Right.
But you got to be able to withstand the voyage there. Under zero, without a gravity field around you. So on the missions I was on, going to Hubble on the shuttle.
Right. Which, by the way, you repaired the Hubble.
I was one of those guys that got to do that.
It was two of you guys out there, and you actually
two
repaired.
Two at a time.
We
have two spacewalking teams, and we were out there taking turns going out 5 days in a row on both of my missions.
That's wild.
Yeah. So repairman in space.
So you...
Mechanic. It's like working on a car with boxing gloves. That's pretty much it is. People ask me astronomy questions, right? And they ask me, like, my neighbors, I'd be like putting out the garbage, and they go, "Hey, Mike," I'm like, "What?" And they go, "No, tonight, isn't it true that Mars?" This is like a question from Neil or one of those. Mars is over here, and it's the only time in 300 years that it's over there, and Venus is there, and we're gonna see some other star come out over there. And I'm like, "I don't know." And they go, "You don't know?" I go, "I have no idea." And they go, "You worked on a Hubble, didn't you?" I go, "Yeah, I don't look through the telescope. I just fix it." So, yeah, the repairman up there.
That's so funny.
Hubble repairman.
You're way too modest, man, a repairman. I'm an astronaut repairman. Who gets to say that?
I can fix almost anything inside of a spacesuit. That's the problem, is that now without the spacesuit, I'm kind of at a loss.
If you're not wearing the suit, you can't enact your superpowers.
If I want to fix a sink, I got to get a helmet on. I'm so used to doing it.
All right, keep your science caps on because the spinning doesn't stop here. For more on weight, mass, gravity, and centripetal force, check out Brilliant's Centripetal Force Quiz. It's part of the classical mechanics course that gets into explaining the core principles of physics and applies them to real-world uses like rockets and space and space stations and drones and zero-G and more. If you're the type of person who hears scientific facts and wonders, hey, how'd they figure that out? Then Brilliant is right for you. It walks you through scientific and mathematical problems, guiding you step by step at your own pace. So you can sign up for free at brilliant.org/StarTalk and get access to weekly puzzles and brain teasers. But if you're one of the first 782 people to subscribe to our annual plan, which gives you access to all the courses across a variety of subjects, including outer space and zero G, you will receive 20% off your annual fee for life. Oh, do you have a catchphrase, Mike?
Zippity doo dah.